Graphic Audio. A movie in your mind.
Graphic Audio presents Warbreaker Part 2, created by Brandon Sanderson, narrated by Dylan Lynch, with performances by David Coyne, James Konicek, Tim Getman, Ren Casey, Elizabeth Jernigan, Colleen Delany, Scott McCormick, Christopher Graybill, Richard Rowan, Mort Shelby, Terence Aselford, Stephen Carpenter, Sonny Lasskey, Eric Messner, Tom Simpson, Amanda Thickpenny, Andy Clemence, Ken Jackson, and Nanette Savard. Warbreaker, Part 2. Vasher stood atop the palace of the God King, watching the sun drop above the western rainforest. The sunset was vibrant amidst the clouds, colors flaring, beautiful reds and oranges painting the trees. Then the sun disappeared and the colors faded. Some said that before a man died, his biochromatic aura flared with sudden brightness, like a heart giving its last beat, like the final surge of a wave before the tide retreats. Vasher had seen it happen, but not with every death. The event was rare, much like a perfect sunset.
Dramatic.
The sunset?
Yes.
You can't see it.
But I can feel you seeing it. Crimson, like blood in the air.
Vasher didn't respond. The sword couldn't see, but with its powerful twisted biochroma, it could sense life and people. Both were things Nightblood had been created to protect. It was strange how easily and quickly protection could cause destruction. Sometimes, Vasher wondered if the two weren't really the same thing. Protect a flower, destroy the pests who wanted to feed on it. Protect a building, destroy the plants that could have grown in the soil. Protect a man, live with the destruction he creates. Although it was dark, Vasher's life sense was strong. He could just faintly feel the grass growing below and knew how far away it was. With more breath, he might even have been able to sense the lichen growing on the palace stones. He knelt down, laying one hand on his trouser leg and one on the stone of the palace.
Strengthen me.
Basha's trouser leg stiffened and a patch of color bled from the black stone beside him. Black was a color. He'd never considered that before he'd become an awakener. Tassels hanging at his cuffs stiffened, wrapping around his ankle. Kneeling as he was, they could also twist around the bottoms of his feet. Basher placed a hand on the shoulder of his shirt, touching another patch of marble as he formed an image in his mind.
Upon call, become my fingers and grip.
The shirt quivered and a group of tassels curled up around his hand. Five of them, like fingers. It was a difficult command. It required far more breath to awaken than he would have liked. His remaining breath barely allowed him the second heightening. And the visualization of the command had taken practice to perfect. The finger tassels were worth it. They had proven very useful, and he was loath to engage in the night's activities without them. He stood up straight, noticing the scar of gray marble on the otherwise perfectly black palace surface. He smiled to think of the indignation the priests would feel when they discovered it. Vasher tested the strength in his legs, gripping Nightblood, then took a careful step off the side of the palace. He fell some 10 feet. Vasher's awakened clothing absorbed some of the shock, acting like a second external set of bones. He stood up, nodding to himself, then jumped down the other pyramid steps. Eventually, he landed on the soft grass north of the palace, close to the wall that surrounded the entire plateau. He crouched, watching quietly.
Sneaking, Vasher? You're terrible at sneaking. You should attack. You're good at that.
You just want to prove how strong you are.
Well, yes. But you do have to admit that you are bad at sneaking.
Vasher ignored the sword. A lone man in ragged clothing carrying a sword across the grounds would be rather conspicuous. So he surveyed. He handpicked a night when the gods hadn't planned any grand celebrations out in the courtyard, but there were still small groups of priests, minstrels, or servants moving between palaces.
How sure are you about this information of yours? Because, honestly, I don't trust priests.
He isn't a priest.
Vasha moved carefully, creeping through the dark starlight shadow of the wall's overhang. His contact had warned him to stay away from the palaces of influential gods like Blushweaver and Stillmar. But he had also said that the palace of a lesser god, like Gift Beacon or Peace Yearning, wouldn't work for Vasha's purpose. Instead, Vasha sought out the home of Mercy Star, a returned known for her involvement in politics, yet who wasn't all that influential. Her palace looked relatively dark this evening, but there would still be guards. Halandrin returned, all had servants to spare. Sure enough, Vasha located two men watching the door he wanted. They wore the extravagant costumes of court servants, colored yellow and gold after the pattern of their mistress. The men weren't armed. Who would attack the home of a returned? They were simply there to keep anyone from wandering in and bothering their lady while she slept. They stood by their lanterns, alert and attentive, but more for the sake of appearances than anything else. Vasha obscured Nightblood beneath his cloak, then walked out of the darkness, looking from side to side anxiously.
The goddess. Yes, I must see the goddess.
He hunched his body to help hide the oversized hidden sword.
Oh, please. The crazy disguise. You're cleverer than that.
It'll work. This is the court of the gods. Nothing attracts the unbalanced more than the prospect of meeting deities. Yes, she will not.
The two guards looked up when they saw him approaching, but they didn't seem surprised.
Here now, how'd you get in here?
The goddess.
The second man put a hand on Vasha's shoulder.
Come on, friend. Let's get you back to the gates and see if there's a shelter that's still taking people in for the night.
Vasha hesitated. Kindness. He hadn't expected that for some reason. The emotion made him feel a tad guilty for what he had to do next. He snapped his arm to the side. The tassel snapped forward, wrapping around the first guard's neck. Before the second guard could react, Vasha brought Nightblood up, ramming the hilt into the guard's stomach. Vasha swept his feet out from beneath him. Vasha's boot followed, coming down slowly but firmly on the man's neck. Vasha stood for a long moment, both men struggling, neither managing to escape their strangulation. A short time later, Vasha stepped off the second guard's neck, then lowered the first guard to the grass, twitching his thumb twice and releasing the finger tassels.
You didn't use me much. You could have used me. I'm better than a shirt. I'm a sword.
Vasha ignored the comments, scanning the darkness to see if he had been spotted.
I really am better than a shirt. I would have killed them. Look, they're still breathing. Stupid shirt.
That was the point. Corpses cause more trouble than men who get knocked out.
I could knock people out.
Vasha shook his head, ducking into the building. Returned palaces, this one included, were generally just collections of open rooms with colorful sheets on the doorways. The weather was so temperate in Halandrin that the building could be open to the air at all times. He didn't go through the central rooms, but instead stayed in the peripheral servant hallway. If Vasha's informant had been truthful, then what he wanted could be found on the northeast side of the building. As he walked, he unraveled the rope from his waist.
Wow, belts are stupid too. They...
At that moment, a group of four servants rounded the corner directly ahead of Vasha. Within a heartbeat, Vasha snapped the rope forward.
Hold things.
The rope wrapped around the arm of one of the servants, though Vasha had been aiming for the neck.
Colors.
Vasha knocked him against the angle of the corner. The others moved to run. Vasha whipped out Nightblood with his other hand.
Yes.
Vasha didn't draw the sword. He simply tossed it forward. The blade came to rest before the three men. One of the group froze, looking down at the sword transfixed. He reached out tentatively, eyes awed. Vasha dashed forward and wrapped the rope around the first servant's hands and body. To his side, the remaining servant ignored both Vasha and his friend. This man picked up Nightblood, eyes alight.
It's so beautiful.
He undid the snap on the hilt, moving to pull the sword. When he had barely gotten a thin sliver of blade free, a dark, fluid-like smoke began to stream out. Some dripped to the ground, other tendrils of it snaked out and wrapped around the man's arm, drawing the color from his skin. Basha kicked out with an awakened leg. Basha grabbed the man who had been holding the sword and rammed his head against the wall. Basha grabbed Nightblood, closed the sheath, and did up the clasp. Then he reached over, touching the rope that tied the dazed servant.
Your breath to mine.
He recovered the breath from the rope, leaving the man bound.
You didn't let me kill him!
No corpses, remember.
And two ran away from me. Oh, that's not right.
You cannot tempt the hearts of men who are pure, Nightblood.
No matter how much Basha explained that concept, it seemed beyond the sword's ability to comprehend. Basha moved quickly, dashing down the hall. He had no desire to fight an army of servants and soldiers. He stopped, uncertain in the unadorned hallway. He noticed, idly, that awakening the rope had inadvertently stolen the color from his boots and cloak, the only pieces of clothing he wore that weren't themselves awakened. The gray clothing would instantly brand him for what he was.
I told you you aren't sneaky.
Shut up.
Basha reached into a pouch at his belt, pulling out the object within. A dead squirrel.
Ooh, yeah.
Basha knelt, putting a hand on the creature.
Awaken to my breath. Serve my needs. Live at my command and my word, fallen rope.
Those last words, fallen rope, formed the security phrase. Basha could have chosen anything, but he picked the first thing that came to mind. One breath leached from his body, going down into the small rodent's corpse. The thing began to twitch. That was a breath Basha would never be able to recover, but creating a lifeless was a permanent act. The squirrel lost all color, bleeding to gray, the awakening feeding off the body's own colors to help fuel the transformation.
Fallen rope.
The security phrase pronounced, Basha could now imprint the creature with an order, much as he did when performing a standard awakening.
Make noise. Run around. Bite people who are not me. Fallen rope.
The squirrel hopped up to its feet, then scampered down the hallway, heading for the open doorway the fleeing servants had disappeared into. Basha stood and began to run again, hoping that this distraction would earn him some time. Lifeless could be difficult to stop, particularly a fresh one with orders to fight.
Oh, we could have taken them.
Basha rushed to the place his information had indicated. The location was marked by a splintered board in the wall, ostensibly just normal wear of the building. Basha crouched, hoping that his informant had not lied. He searched around on the floor, then froze as he found the hidden latch. He pulled it open, revealing a trap door.
What if this tunnel doesn't have another way out?
Then you'll probably get to kill a lot of people.
Weatherlove, god of storms, selected one of the wooden spheres from the rack, then hefted it in his hand. It had been built to fill the palm of a god and was weighted in the middle with lead. Carved with rings across the surface, it was painted a deep blue. Life Blesser eyed the other god's choice critically.
A doubling sphere! A bold move!
Weatherlove eyed the small group of gods behind him. Lightsong was among them, sipping on a sweet, orange-fruited drink with some kind of alcohol enhancement. It had been several days since he'd allowed Larimar to talk him out of bed, but he still had come to no conclusion on how to proceed.
A bold move indeed. Tell me, Lightsong the Bold, do you favor this throw?
There were four of them playing. As usual, Weatherlove wore a green and gold robe that hung from only one shoulder with a wrap around his waist that came down to mid-thigh. The outfit, patterned after the ancient dress of the returned from painting centuries past, revealed his sculpted muscles and divine figure. He stood at the edge of the balcony as it was his turn to throw. Seated behind him were the three others. Lightsong on the left and Lifeblesser, god of healing in the middle. Truthcall, god of justice, sat on the far right wearing his ornate cloak and uniform of maroon and white. The three gods were all variations on a theme. If Lightsong hadn't known them well, he would have had trouble telling them apart. Each stood almost exactly 7 feet tall, with bulging muscles that any mortal would have envied. True, Lifeblesser had brown hair, while Weatherlove had blonde and Truthcall had black. But all three had that same set of square-jawed features, perfect coiffure, and innate seamless grace that marked them as returned divinities. Only their costumes really offered any variety.
Do I bless your throw, Weatherlove? Are we not in competition against one another?
I suppose.
Then why would I bless you when you throw against me?
Weatherlove just smirked, then pulled back his arm and launched the ball out across the pitch. It bounced, then rolled over the grass, eventually coming to rest. This section of the courtyard had been divided into an expansive game board with ropes and stakes. Priests and servants scurried about on the sides, making notations and keeping track of the score so that the gods wouldn't have to. Tarashin was a complex game played only by the wealthy. Lightsong had never bothered to learn the rules. He found it more amusing to play when he had no idea what he was doing. It was his throw next. He stood up, selecting one of the wooden spheres from the rack because it matched the color of his drink. He tossed the orange sphere up and down, then, not paying attention to where he was throwing, he tossed it out onto the field. The sphere flew much farther than it probably should have. He had the strength of a perfect body. That was part of the reason the field was so vast. It had to be built to the scale of gods. And so when they played, they required the elevated perspective of a balcony to view their game. Tarashin was supposed to be one of the most difficult games in the world. It required strength to throw the spheres correctly, keen wit to understand where to place them, coordination to do so with the necessary precision, and a great understanding of strategy to pick the proper sphere and dominate the game field.
413 points.
Another magnificent throw. How do you do it? I never have thought to use a reversal sphere for that throw.
Is that what the orange ones are called? You just have to understand the playing field, Truthcall, and learn to get inside the mind of the sphere. Think like it does, reason as it might.
Reason like a sphere?
Lifeblesser stood up. He wore flowing robes of his colors blue and silver. He selected a green sphere off the rack, then stared at it.
What type of reasoning does a wooden sphere do?
The circular type, I should think. And by coincidence, it is my favorite type as well. Perhaps that's why I'm so good at the game.
Lifeblesser frowned, opening his mouth to reply. He finally shut it, looking confused by Lightsong's comment. Becoming a god did not, unfortunately, increase one's mental capacity along with one's physical attributes. Lightsong didn't mind. For him, the real sport of a game of Tarashin never involved where the spheres landed. Lifeblesser made his throw, then sat down.
I do say, Lightsong, I mean this as a compliment, but having you around can be draining.
Yes, I'm remarkably like a mosquito in that regard. Truthcall, isn't it your throw?
Actually, it's yours again. You achieved the crown pairing during your last toss, remember?
Yes, how could I forget?
Lightsong took another sphere, tossed it over his shoulder out onto the green, then sat down.
507 points.
Now you're just showing off.
Lightsong said nothing. In his opinion, it revealed an inherent flaw in the game that the one who knew least about it tended to do the best. He doubted, however, that the others would take it that way. All three were very dedicated to their sport, and they played every week. There was blessed little else for them to do with their time. Lightsong suspected that they only kept inviting him because they wanted to prove, at last, that they could defeat him. If he'd fathomed the rules, he'd have tried to lose on purpose to keep them from insisting that he come play with them. Still, he liked the way his victories annoyed them, though, of course, they never showed him anything other than perfect decorum. Either way, under the circumstances, he suspected that he couldn't lose if he wanted to. It was rather difficult to throw a game when you had no idea what you were doing to win it in the first place. Truthcall finally stepped up to throw. He always wore clothing of a martial style, and the colors maroon and white were very handsome on him. Lightsong suspected that he'd always been jealous that instead of being given lifeless commands as his duty to the court, he'd been given a vote over issues of trade with other kingdoms.
I hear that you spoke with the Queen a few days back, Lightsong.
Yes, indeed. She was extraordinarily pleasant, I must say.
The entire court is abuzz.
Truthball turned and flipped back his cape, then leaned against the balcony railing as he waited for the points from his throw to be tabulated.
The Edrians betrayed the treaty, one could say.
The wrong princess. It gives us an opening.
Yes, but an opening for what?
To attack.
Oh, there is so much more to be gained than that, life blesser.
Yes, my plans are already in motion, of course.
And what plans would those be, divine brother?
I wouldn't want to spoil the surprise now, would I?
That depends. Will it keep me from demanding the Idrians give us more access to the passes? I'm willing to bet that some pressures could be placed on the new queen to gain her favor for such a proposal. She's said to be rather naive.
Lightsong felt a slight nausea as they spoke. He knew how they plotted, always scheming. They played their game with spheres, but just as much of their reason for seeing each other at these events was to posture and make deals.
Her ignorance must be an act. They wouldn't have sent her if she was really that inexperienced.
She's Idrian. Their most important city has fewer people than a small Tatalan neighborhood. They barely understand the concept of politics, I'll warrant. They are more used to talking to sheep than humans.
Even if she's well-trained by their standards, she'll be easy to manipulate here. The real trick is going to be to make certain others don't get to her first. Lightsong, what was your impression? Will she be quick to do as the gods tell her?
I really wouldn't know. As you know, I'm not much interested in political games.
Weatherlove and Truthcall shared a smirking look. Like most in the court, they considered Lightsong hopeless when it came to practical matters. And, by their definition, practical meant taking advantage of others.
Lightsong, you really need to take more of an interest in politics. It can be very diverting. Why, if you only knew the secrets to which I'm privy.
My dear life blesser, please trust me when I say that I have no desire to know any secrets which involve you and a privy.
Life blesser frowned, obviously trying to work through that one. The other two began to discuss the queen again as the priest reported the score from the last throw. Oddly, Lightsong found himself increasingly troubled. As life blesser stood up to take his next toss, Lightsong found himself rising as well.
My divine brothers, I suddenly feel quite weary. Perhaps it was something I ingested.
Not something I served, I hope.
Food, no. The other things you're serving today? Perhaps. I really must be on my way.
But you're in the lead. If you leave now, we'll have to play again next week.
Ooh, your threats roll off me like water, my divine brother. I bid you farewell until such time as you drag me up here again to play this tragic game of yours.
Lightsong left the palace and entered the green outside. To the right, a complex network of rope squares and patterns marked the tarishing pitch. A sphere bounced in the grass. Lightsong walked the other direction on the springing lawn, not waiting for his priests to erect a canopy to shade him from the afternoon sun. He still worried that if he tried to help, he'd just make things worse. But then there were the dreams. War and violence. Over and over again, he saw the fall of Tatalir itself, the destruction of his homeland. He couldn't continue to ignore the dreams, even if he didn't accept them as prophetic. Blushweaver thought that war was important, or at least that it was important to prepare for. He trusted her more than any other god or goddess, but he also worried about how aggressive she was. She had come to him, asking him to be a part of her plans. Had she done it, perhaps, because she knew he would be more temperate than she? Was she intentionally balancing herself? Larimar had told him to do his best. That sounded like an awful lot of work. Unfortunately, doing nothing was beginning to seem like even more work. Sometimes, when you stepped in something foul, the only thing to do was to stop walking and make the effort to clean it off.
I am probably going to regret this.
Then, he went looking for Blushweaver. The man was slight, almost skeletal, and each shellfish she slurped made Vivenna cringe for two reasons. Not only did she have trouble believing that anyone would enjoy such slimy, slug-like food, but the mussels were also of a very rare and expensive variety. And she was paying. Denth and Tonk Fa sat on either side of her. And, of course, they helped themselves to the plate of mussels as well.
That's good.
Vivenna wasn't certain. She pointedly not asked, but she thought that the shellfish were raw. The thin man across from her didn't seem to be enjoying himself much, despite the expensive surroundings and free food. He had a sneer on his lips, and while he didn't appear nervous, she did notice that he kept an eye on the restaurant entrance.
So, can you help us or not?
The little man, he called himself Fob, shrugged.
You tell a wild tale, mercenary.
Well, you know me, Fob. When have I lied to you?
Whenever you've been paid to do it. I've just never been able to catch you.
You don't disagree that war is coming, though?
Of course not. But it's been coming for decades now. What makes you think that it would finally happen this year?
Can you afford to ignore the chance that it might?
Fob was a landowner. He cleared forests, then rented the land to growers. He often relied on Lifeless to help with his clearing, workers loaned to him through the government. There was only one stipulation upon the lending. Should war come, all of the food produced on his holdings during wartime immediately became the property of the returned. It was a good deal. The government would probably seize his lands during a war anyway, so he didn't really lose anything save for his right to complain.
How does he keep packing them down?
Fob had managed to slurp away nearly twice as many of the disgusting little creatures as Tonk Fa.
The harvest won't come in, Fob. You will lose quite a bit this year, should we prove right.
But harvest early, sell your stockpiles, and you stand to get ahead of your competitors.
And what do you gain? How do I know those same competitors haven't hired you to convince me a war is coming?
Vivenna pulled back her shawl, not the matronly one she'd brought from Idris, but a silken gossamer one that Denth had found for her. She met Fob's eyes, then changed her hair to a deep red.
Do that again.
Vivenna changed it to blonde.
Queen?
No, her sister.
What's going on here?
She's here to organize a resistance against the returned gods and to prepare Idrian interests here in Taitalia for the coming war.
You don't think that old royal up in the highlands would send his daughter for nothing? War is the only thing that would call for such desperation.
Your sister? They sent the younger one into the court. Why?
The king's plans are his own, Fob.
I knew there was more behind that girl's arrival than simple chance.
So you'll harvest?
I'll think about it.
Good enough, I guess.
Denth nodded to Vivenna and Tonk Fa, and the three of them left Fob eating his shellfish. Vivenna settled the tab, which was even higher than she'd feared, and then they joined Parlin, Jules, and Claude, the lifeless, waiting outside. The group moved away from the restaurant, pushing through the crowd easily, if only because of the massive lifeless that walked before them.
Where now?
Not tired, even a little.
We're working for the good of my people, Denth. A little weariness is a small price.
Denth shot a glance toward Tonk Fa, but the overweight mercenary had split off into the crowd toward a merchant stand, Parlin tagging along behind. Parlin, Vivenna noticed, had gone back to wearing his ridiculous green hat despite her disapproval. What was wrong with that man? He wasn't terribly bright, true, but he had always been level-headed.
Jules, take us to the Raymar place.
Jules nodded, giving instructions to Claude that Vivenna couldn't hear. The group turned in another direction through the crowd.
It only responds to her.
It has basic instructions to do what Tonks and I say, and I've got a security phrase I can use if I need more control.
Security phrase?
This is a rather heretical discussion we're getting into. Are you sure you want to continue?
I still do not like the idea of that thing being with us, particularly if I don't have any way to control it.
All awakening works by way of command, Princess. You infuse something with life, then give it an order. Lifeless are valuable because you can give them commands after you create them, unlike regular awakened objects, which you can only command once in advance. Plus, lifeless can remember a long list of complicated orders and are generally good about not misunderstanding them. They retain a bit of their humanity, I guess. However, that means pretty much anyone can control a lifeless, not just the person who created them. So we give them security phrases. A couple words you can say that will let you imprint the creature with new commands.
So, What's the security phrase for Claude?
I'll have to ask Jules if you can have it.
Vivenna opened her mouth to complain, but thought better of it. Denth obviously didn't like interfering with Jules or her work. Vivenna would simply have to make a point of it later, once they were in a more private location. Instead, she just eyed Claude. He was dressed in simple clothing, gray trousers and gray shirt, with a leather jerkin that had been drained of color. He carried a large blade at his waist, not a dueling sword, a more brutal, broad-bladed weapon.
All in gray. Is that because they want everyone to recognize Claude for a lifeless?
Despite what Denth said about lifeless being common, many people gave the thing a wide berth.
Snakes might be common in the jungle, but that doesn't mean that people are pleased to see them.
Jules chatted quietly at the lifeless, though it never responded. It simply walked, face forward, inhuman in the steady rhythm of its steps.
Does she always talk to it like that?
Yeah.
That doesn't seem very healthy.
Dent looked troubled, though he said nothing. A few moments later, Tongfa and Parlin returned. Tongfa, Vivenna was displeased to see, had a small monkey on his shoulder. It then ran behind Tongfa's neck, moving to the other shoulder.
A new pet? What happened to that parrot of yours anyway?
Tongfa looked ashamed, and Denth just shook his head.
Tonks isn't very good with pets.
That parrot was boring anyway. Monkeys are much more interesting.
Vivenna shook her head. It wasn't long before they arrived at the next restaurant, one far less lavish than the previous one. Jules, Parlin, and the lifeless took up places outside as usual, and Vivenna and the two male mercenaries walked in. The meetings were becoming routine. During the last couple of weeks, they'd met with at least a dozen people of varying usefulness. Some were underground leaders Dent thought might be capable of making a ruckus. Others were merchants, like Fob. All in all, Vivenna was impressed with the variety of covert ways Denth had come up with to disrupt things in Taetalir. Most of the schemes did, however, require a display of Vivenna's royal locks as a clincher. Most people instantly grasped the importance of a royal daughter being in the city, and she was left wondering just how Lemix had intended to achieve results without such convincing proof. Denth led them to a table in the corner, and Vivenna frowned.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.